All right, so we're going to be picking up where we left off from last week. And for those of you who haven't been joining us regularly, we're going through the book of Genesis, but we got to the point where we're going to be transitioning from Noah and his descendants to now Abraham and Genesis 12. And that will be next week. But we took a two-week break in Genesis just to give us a little bit of a breather as we're going through all the genealogies and the names and the places and the stuff. I just felt like we needed to have just a little bit of a breather in that. So we're taking a two-week hiatus in Genesis, and we're going through 3 John. And a lot of people don't really talk about 3 John. We don't discuss what's in there. Mainly, I mean, it's a small book. There's not a lot to it. There's only 15 verses. So I think that's probably why a lot of people, they probably have never even read it before. Or if they have, it's been like I'm just going to read through this in 5 seconds and then move on to Jude or something. And then you read through that in 5 seconds too. But yeah, so it's one of those small books, but it's got a lot in it if you really kind of dig down a little bit. And that's what I wanted to do over these last 2 weeks, is take a look at what is being said, what is being taught, what can we learn from it? Because there's actually a lot of early church stuff going on in this letter that we need to pay attention to, because it affects us as a church as well. I mentioned 3 John is actually the shortest book in the Bible. Last week I talked about this briefly. It is 15 verses, and 2 John is actually less verses, but it's more words. So it's actually longer, even though it's less verses, which is kind of funny, because we think about it and it's like, oh my gosh, it's so short. But in fact, this one's shorter. It's more verses. The verses weren't there when they wrote the letter. The verses and the chapters and all that stuff, it wasn't there. It was all one big parchment, and they're sending the letter, so it doesn't count. So anyway, the overall theme of this book is to commend those who are walking in the truth, hence our slide, walking in the truth, and also condemning the wicked within the church. And there's actually some very specific concepts that we're going to be talking about today when it comes to condemning the wicked in the church, because this is really, really important, and we're actually living in a time where this is very applicable, I guess I could say. So why don't we stand for the reading of the Word of God? We do that as we begin our time of study. And we're going to pick up where we left off in 3 John. We're going to pick up at verse 9. And this is what it says in verses 9 and 10. John the Apostle says, I wrote something to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to be first among them, does not accept what we say. For this reason, if I come, I will call attention to his deeds, which he does, unjustly accusing us with wicked words, and not satisfied with this, he himself does not receive the brethren either, and he forbids those who desire to do so and puts them out of the church. Let's pray. Father God, we are grateful for this day. God, we thank you for the beautiful weather. We thank you for the freedom and the opportunity that we get to gather here in this neighborhood, in this school, as a congregation. We're grateful, God, that we have this opportunity to worship you and the freedom to do so unhindered. I pray, God, that you would be glorified through what we do and through our time of study in your word and through our worship of you. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. All right, so as you can see, the tone of these two verses that we're looking at right now is taking a pretty serious turn. In the previous section, what we were looking at last week, there was a lot of positive feedback happening. There's a lot of encouragement and commending. John was commending the faithfulness of his beloved brother Gaius, to whom he was writing this letter. Gaius is the recipient of the letter. It's a personal letter. It wasn't meant to be circulated throughout the churches like some of the other letters that were written by Paul and stuff. He's addressing a church. It's meant to be read aloud to the congregation. It's meant to be circulated. This one was a personal letter that John wrote to Gaius. And he was commending Gaius, saying, hey man, I've heard your reputation. I've heard you're a good guy, and that you're loving people. You're showing Christian love to your brothers and sisters in Christ. And you're showing hospitality to those who are traveling missionaries, to those who are traveling teachers and evangelists. You're hosting them. You're taking care of their needs so that they can devote themselves to the work of the gospel. And he's walking in the truth. That's what John says about Gaius. He's proud of him. He's encouraged and he's joyful because Gaius is walking in the truth. And so we see that this is indicative of the love of his love for the brethren. And we also saw last week that this is how the world will know that we are Christians. It's by our love for one another. We saw this last week in John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. It says this, Jesus is speaking to his disciples, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Even I have loved you, even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." And so Jesus is telling these things to his disciples, and John is there receiving that word from Jesus, and he goes on to teach the same thing, right? And so as he's interacting with Gaius and he's teaching Gaius, Gaius is staying faithful to the teaching of the apostles, to the teaching of Jesus. And John is proud of him. He's filled with joy because of that. And so in this encouragement to his spiritual son, now he shifts from praising Gaius to addressing a concerning situation. Now, this is quite interesting, and we do have to speculate a little bit, but I think we can stand on pretty solid ground with some of the things that I'm about to say. Most of the things I'm about to say, there are some things that we're not 100% sure about. One of those things is that Gaius belonged to a church. We don't know where. It's thought that John may have been the bishop of the church in Ephesus during this time. And so perhaps maybe he is referring to the church in Ephesus, or he is in Ephesus referring to another church where Gaius is located. And so we don't know exactly the location of it, but we do know that John had written another letter to the church where Gaius is possibly located, where he possibly belongs. We don't know exactly for sure. I think, based on what the text is telling us, that Gaius probably belongs to the church that John is trying to write to. That way, Gaius has intimate familiarity with what is happening. And he also knows who this Diotrephes guy is, which we're going to talk about in just a second. But we see that this letter was sent to the church, and what was sent was rejected by this man named Diotrephes. And we're assuming that he belonged to the same church. And not only that, but we also can see that he held a leadership role within the church. And we're going to get to that in just a second. We don't know a lot about this man. This is the only time in the Bible that he's mentioned. But what we can tell about who he is as a man and his character is that he is willing to do things that he should not be doing. We know that he is slandering John and others, and he's also willing to make unjust and false accusations. And so that speaks to his character and his willingness to do what is important for him. Furthermore, we also see that Diotrephes is not willing to receive missionaries, traveling teachers who are sent to their church. Not only this, but he forbids others within the church to accept them and receive them as well. And he threatens them that he would kick them out of the church if they took them in. Now, we don't know for certain if these men are sent by John or if they're just traveling teachers or maybe a little bit of both. But we do know with certainty that these are men who are testifying to John about Gaius and about the things that are taking place in this church. And so John is hearing of these things. He's hearing the reports that are coming back to him. And these are very, very concerning. Based on what we see here also, we see that Diotrephes is in a position to where he can elevate himself. And it says in verse 9 that he loves to be first among the church. It says that this church that he's going to, that he attends, he loves to be first among them. And I think that that's really telling about the character of this man. He has a desire for power and influence. And because of that desire, it causes him to come into conflict with the Apostle John, who is an apostle. He's one who walked with Jesus. He received the teaching from Jesus directly. And so now he's having to conflict with this man. And so Diotrephes is rejecting what John is teaching, and he's making false accusations against him. This is a really important point, church, that I think we need to make sure that we're focusing on. I think, and this is really, really pertinent even in today's modern church. The health of a church is directly influenced by those in leadership positions. And this is why we see things take place within churches that can be really, really healthy or really, really unhealthy. Really, the church body, the congregation that meets locally within a building or a city or whatever, rises and falls on the spiritual health of the leader, of the leadership. And it doesn't necessarily have to be the pastor. It can be an elder board that's corrupt or seeking power, seeking to usurp the pastor's authority. Or it can be a worship leader or a youth leader or an associate pastor. It doesn't necessarily have to be the lead pastor. And we don't know what the role that Diotrephes played, but he did have a role of influence. And what we're seeing here now is that the spiritual health of the church is directly influenced by this man who is not only being slanderous against a fellow elder, perhaps, and brother in Christ, someone who should be shown honor and respect because of his position that God gave him, not because of what he earned himself, but because God gave him that position, right? He's slandering this man, but he's also rejecting eating brothers and sisters in Christ. He's not only doing that, but he's forbidding others within the church to do the same, which is something that we as a church are called to do, right? We're called to be hospitable. We're called to love one another and take care of each other. And he's literally forbidding them to do that and threatening them with kicking them out. There have been a number of churches, some very high profile, that have risen and fallen because of the leadership of the church, even in modern times. And I know that you guys are aware of at least a few of them. Brooke and I were listening to a podcast about the rise and fall of Mars Hill, which was in Seattle, Washington, Mark Driscoll. It's a fascinating story. It's a fascinating chain of events that takes place. And ultimately, the church rose to popularity, grew to huge numbers, and fell very, very quickly because of their senior pastor, because of his abusive behavior, because of him talking down to people and not necessarily misusing scripture, but misusing the authority that he was given as a pastor. He was divisive. There was all kind of anger, and people, they didn't feel as though their shepherd was shepherding them, right? They felt abused by this man. And that is just one example of abuse that pastors can do to their congregations, their flock. And we see, I mean, we saw last week that 1 Peter tells us, you know, there is a calling for elders among the church. We're to shepherd the flock. Not for sordid gain, not for personal gain or for power or influence, but we're to do it just as Christ shepherds the flock. He's our chief shepherd, right? He is our example. We're going to look at that in just a second. But these people are coming into the church, and we see them. They're wolves in sheep's clothing. We talked about that last week. That's how we know about them. We're able to look at their fruits and judge them. And so we see that pride now, in this particular case, it's a focal sin. This Diotrephes guy is desiring to occupy a position that only Christ deserves. And let me expound on that a little bit in Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. It says this, "He, Christ, is also head of the body, the church, and he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have first place in everything." Christ is first in the church. He is head of the church. He is our boss, so to speak, right? He's our shepherd. And now he has put in place kind of a church government type of system or formula, whatever you want to call it. He has appointed that some people would take speaking and leadership roles within the church, because that is necessary amongst human beings. That's necessary amongst gatherings. There needs to be people who are willing to take the reins, so to speak, and give vision and leadership and direction. And that's normal. That is biblical. But Christ is first. And the people who are in leadership must acknowledge that. We must place ourselves underneath the leadership, underneath the headship of Christ, or else then we become inflated. We become the people, the person, so to speak, that people come to and ask for direction and wisdom and guidance and stuff like that. And as a pastor, that's okay for me to answer questions and give guidance and wisdom. I mean, that's okay for me to do, but ultimately, it's not from me, right? It's from God. The wisdom that I have comes from God, not from me. I'm nobody special, right? I'm just a guy. I put my pants on one leg at a time, just like everyone else. But we have roles within the church, and we exercise our spiritual gifts according to the gifting that we've been given. And that goes along with roles as well as giftings. But Christ is first. The interesting thing about this is that this echoes what Jesus taught on as far as the Pharisees are concerned. In Matthew chapter 23 is one of the examples we see in the Gospels that Jesus is calling out the Pharisees on this very sin. He says this in verse 6, "They love the place of honor at banquets and the chief seats in the synagogues and respectful greetings in the marketplaces and being called rabbi by men. But do not be called rabbi, for one is your teacher, and you are all brothers." That's Jesus talking to us, right? Well, yes, of course, you know, there's people that have the gifting of pastor and teacher and all that, and, you know, evangelist, all that good stuff. Those are giftings, and those are roles within the church body that we play, but there is one teacher, and there is one rule book by which we play. And that governs everything that we do, and that is Christ. He is the only rabbi we need. He is the only teacher we need. And now, there is an interesting story, and I found this very ironic when I was doing my studies. There's a very interesting story that I want to read to you guys in Mark chapter 10. This is fascinating to me because John is literally dealing with this very thing right now in this letter of 3 John. But John had to learn this lesson himself the hard way. So Mark chapter 10, starting at verse 35, we're going to see something that's very interesting. I want you guys to pay attention to what's happening here. James and John, the two sons of Zebedee, came up to Jesus saying, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" They said to him, "Grant that we may sit one on your right and one on your left in glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" They said to him, "We are able." And Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you shall drink, and you shall be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized. But to sit on my right or on my left, this is not mine to give, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." Hearing this, the ten began to feel indignant with James and John. Calling them to himself, Jesus said to them, "You know that those who are recognized as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great men exercise authority over them. But it is not this way among you. But whoever wishes to be great among you shall be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you shall be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. I want you guys to catch that, because what is Diotrephes wanting to do? He's wanting to be first, right? He wants to be first among his congregation. And he's going about it the wrong way. He's exercising authority and influence and causing people to stumble. And instead, what he ought to be doing, as we see from Jesus, is that he should be serving as a leader. And ultimately, that is what leadership in the church looks like. It looks like service. It looks like devotion to the body of Christ. That's what true leadership in the church looks like. And we need to be like Christ. Now, I mention this because John is literally doing the same thing as Diotrephes, right? I want to sit at your right hand. The sitting at Jesus' right and left hand when he comes into glory, they're thinking Jesus is going to be king. We want to sit on either side of him. That means that is a position of prominence. It's a position of power and authority and influence. To sit at the right and the left hand of the king, that's huge. And they're doing the exact same thing, right? They actually were known as the sons of thunder. That should tell us something about who they are. That tells us something about their character. They were men of action, right? They want to call down fire on people who disrespected Jesus, right? These are sons of thunder. Now look at John. Look at who he is, John the Apostle, John the Elder. He's a man of love. He's a man of peace. He's a man of wisdom and calm. And he wants the brethren to love one another. He is known as the Apostle of Love. But we're going to see here very shortly, he still is that son of thunder. He's still that man who is really willing to act. And so we need to be like Christ. We need to be like Christ. We see this in Philippians chapter 2. Paul is speaking to the church in Philippi. He says this, "Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interest of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." This is the ultimate act of service and sacrifice that our Lord and Savior gave. And it also is the ultimate act of humility. Now, we don't have time to go into the kenosis, the pouring out, the emptying of Christ. We don't have time to get into that, but I want you to see that he humbled himself. The God of the universe, the Son of the Trinity, of the Godhead, took on flesh. He did not regard equality with God something to be grasped after or wrestled with or attained. He already had it. He already was equal with the Father in everything, in divinity. But he emptied himself and became a servant to death. And so we need to look at this. We do nothing with selfishness or empty conceit. We do it with humility. It's one of our five core values of this church is humility. And we regard one another as more important than yourselves. That doesn't mean people are more important than you. We just regard them as more important. Because when we do that, we treat them with respect. If we regard someone as being more important than us, then we're going to serve and love and show respect to that person. We don't just look out for our own personal interests, but we look out for the interests of others whom we view as more important. And really, when the body does this, when every single one of us within the body of Christ does this, think about all the needs that are met, right? Think about what we as believers can do for one another by regarding each other as more important, by serving each other and taking care of the needs of each other, right? That is the example. Now, Paul also laid out a standard for church leadership. Peter did that as well, but Paul did this in the book of Titus. Titus is really one of my favorite books in the New Testament. I love whenever I start like a new Bible study series or something like that, Titus is my go-to. It's three chapters. You go through it pretty quick, but it is packed with good stuff. All right, so Titus. So in Titus chapter 1, Paul is referring, he's talking to one of his disciples, Titus, who has taken a leadership role on, and he's instructing him on what needs to take place in the church in Crete, the island of Crete. And so this is what he says starting in verse 7. He says, "For the overseer must be above reproach." Overseer can be exchanged with elder, so you guys can know that. The overseer, the elder, he must above reproach as God's steward. Not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not addicted to wine, not pugnacious, that means you want to fight, not fond of sordid gain, but hospitable, loving what is good, sensible, just, devout, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word, which is in accordance with the teaching, so that he will be able to both exhort to in sound doctrine and to refute those who contradict. For there are many rebellious men, empty talkers and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision, who must be silenced because they are upsetting whole families, teaching things they should not teach for the sake of sordid gain. And then if we jump over to verse 16, he can kind of conclude this by saying, they profess to know God, but by their deeds they deny him, being detestable and disobedient and worthless for any good deed. Now I want you guys to notice something. This is the standard for an overseer or an elder in the church, right? And so we kind of see this as being the role of the pastor. This is the benchmark for me, right? This is the benchmark for anybody who would seek to have a leadership role in the church. Does this mean that I attain to this perfectly? No. Is anybody perfect? Is anybody without sin? No. If they say they are, they're liars. That's what 1 John says. We're going to get to that in a little while. But just because we sin doesn't mean that we don't try to hold to this standard. And I want you to notice the very first thing that they're supposed to be is hospitable. That's the very first thing listed. We must be hospitable, right? And also, we need to be able to teach. We need to hold fast to the word of the teaching, which we use to exhort in sound doctrine and refute those who contradict. This is a high calling. John is a perfect example of this. Now, we don't know exactly what Diotrephes is rejecting in John's writings. We can surmise that part of it may have to do with hospitality. It may be that John had instructed the church to receive the people that he had been sending as itinerant preachers, as traveling teachers, so to speak. We don't know for sure, but we do know that whatever John had in that letter, which I think is lost to the church at this point, was rejected by Diotrephes. He didn't just reject it, though. He didn't just say, we're not listening to him. We're not following what he said. He seemed to feel the need to slander John and sully his reputation, presumably so that John's influence in the church would suffer. And gosh, if there's any applicable, relatable thing that we can think about, it is listening to political ads and think about all the mudslinging and the sullying of reputation and backbiting that these politicians are doing to one another, right? And why do they do it? Why do they do it? Because they want you to think something about that particular person, right? oh, so-and-so did this, and he didn't hold true to his word, and he voted this way, and he whatever. He hates people. He's a racist. He's a Nazi, whatever. Why? Because he want whoever's doing the slandering wants to degrade the reputation of the person that he's speaking ill about. He wants you to think negatively about that person so that you don't listen to that person, so you don't vote for that person, right? That's the whole reason why these guys do it. I think it's terrible, but it's widespread, especially right now. We've got midterm, or not midterms, we've got elections coming up next month, and I mean, I don't, have you guys been paying attention to the political ads at all? I'm sick of it. I hate it. It drives me nuts. It's like, man, I tune you out when you start bad mouthing people. I want to know what platform do you stand on, right? What are you going to do as a politician, as a leader in government? What are you going to do? What are you going to accomplish? Diotrephes is taking the exact same tone and tact. He's just going to slander John, and he's going to use his influence to make the church do something that it never should do. Now, in doing so, I don't think he realizes this, and when he does this, but in doing so, Diotrephes is not rejecting necessarily the missionaries. He's not necessarily even rejecting John. But in fact, what he's doing is he's rejecting the one who sent them. And we actually see this in the Gospel of John. We go back to chapter 13, a few verses before what we were just looking at. Jesus says this to his disciples. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who receives whomever I send receives me. And he who receives me receives him who sent me. The opposite is also true. And we do see that in Scripture, but it was a little bit more, and I wanted to save time. But I think you guys get it, right? If you receive the teacher, the preacher, the missionary, you receive the one who sent him, which was Jesus. And if you receive Jesus, you receive the one who sent him, which is God the Father. Of course, if you reject that person, you are also rejecting the one who sent him, right? It's the same thing we see with ambassadorships. And we don't mistake this, church. We are ambassadors for Christ, all of us. We are ambassadors for Christ. 2 Corinthians tells us this. So when we go out into the world and the world rejects us, really they're not rejecting us. They're rejecting the one who sent us, which is Jesus. Because we, church, are sent. That is the Great Commission. Matthew chapter 28. Go, all of us, go and make disciples. Teach what Jesus taught. Baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We, church, are to do that. Not just me, all of us. And so when we go and we share the gospel, we share the good news of Jesus and what he did for us on the cross, that we can have salvation from our sins, and we're rejected by the world, they're not rejecting us. They're rejecting the one who sent us. Obviously, this should not be taking place within the church. There should be no rejection of the brethren within the church, right? As long as sound doctrine is being preached and we're loving each other as brothers and sisters in Christ, there should be no rejection of anybody. All are welcome. That's not what Diotrephes was doing. He was wrongly influencing the church in his position of leadership to be inhospitable and threatening those who would welcome traveling missionaries. This was actually something that was fairly common, unfortunately. Paul had to deal with this also. And we actually see this in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. We see Paul is addressing the church there. I just want to read this to you guys because Paul is exhorting the church in Corinth. And this is actually the second letter that we have in Scripture to the church in Corinth. But we believe it's actually the fourth letter that Paul wrote to the church. There were dialogues going back and forth. We think that there were four different letters, but this was the fourth of, and the last one that we think he sent to them. This is what he says in chapter 10 at the beginning of it. He says, "Now I, Paul, myself, urge you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, And now he kind of says this tongue-in-cheek, this next section, because it's kind of sarcastic towards them because of what he's heard from them and what they've said to him. He says, I who am meek when face-to-face with you, but bold towards you when absent. I ask that when I am present, I need not be bold with the confidence with which I propose to be courageous against some who regard us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. We are destroying speculations and every lofty thing raised up against the knowledge of God, and we are taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. And we are ready to punish all disobedience whenever your obedience is complete. You are looking at things as they are outwardly. If anyone is confident in himself that he is Christ's, let him consider this again within himself, that just as he is Christ's, so also are we. For even if I boast somewhat further about our authority, which the Lord gave for building you up and not for destroying you, I will not be put to shame. For I do not wish to seem as if I would terrify you by my letters. For they say his letters are weighty and strong, but his personal presence is unimpressive and his speech contemptible. This is what people are saying about Paul the Apostle. Can you believe it? He says this, let such a person consider this, that what we are in word by letters when absent, such persons we are also indeed when present. Paul does not mince words. He doesn't let these people have their way with the word of God and the church of God. He stands strong and he is bold to stand for the gospel, to stand for what we as Christians are called to do. And when people are false teachers and they're leading people astray with their false words and their deceptions, he stands firm against that. He exhorts, not just by his physical presence, but by the power and the Spirit of God, by the authority that God gave him as an apostle. And we see also, as we go back and look at what we see in Titus, that overseers, elders, pastors, leaders in the church are to do the same thing. We are to follow the teaching of Christ, and we are to exhort in sound doctrine and also refute those who want to lead people astray. That's what we're supposed to do, church. That's what we're supposed to do. Diotrephes is doing it wrong. Now, John, in verse 10, he makes known to Gaius, the Greek translation for the word, or the English translation for the Greek word, it's translated if in verse 10, but actually, the better translation is whenever. In other words, I don't know when it's going to happen, but when it happens, when I come, when he goes to that church, he will call Diotrephes out on his unjustified accusations and his ungodly deeds. This is what he, as an apostle, is called to do. And in fact, we see Paul exhorting Timothy to do the same thing. Remember, Timothy was a disciple of Paul's who also was leading a church. He was pastoring a church. And we see Paul instructing Timothy to do the same thing. He says in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 20, he says, those who continue in sin rebuke in the presence of all so that the rest also will be fearful of sinning. Now again, don't misunderstand. This fear is not of man. This fear is not of what I personally can do. This is a fear of God. This is the fear of holding to sound doctrine. This is the fear of missing the mark and straying from God. That's the whole reason why we're given the Word of God, so that we can know how we ought to live our lives And we do not want to stray from that. And yet it is in people's interests to gain, to have sordid gain, to benefit in power and influence and stature, to have their own influence. And we need to stand against that. We need to rebuke that. And we need to do that publicly so that others would not be led astray. Now let's move forward. John has addressed this concern. He's addressed this need. And then he says this right after in 3 John verse 11. He says, "Beloved, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. The one who does good is of God. The one who does evil has not seen God." This goes back to one of the points that we had last week, and that is that the evidence of our faith shows through in our lives. The evidence of who we are in Christ shows through in our actions. Our faith is made manifest by what we choose to do in our lives. And so I ask you, church, do you belong to Christ? Are you His? There's a very important thing that Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse 27. He says this, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." Are you following Christ? Are you one of His sheep? Does He know you? These are questions that only you can answer. But I hope that you answer in the affirmative. I hope that you say, "I belong to Christ." And if we do belong to Christ, we need to imitate what is good. We need to follow His example, right? We see in Ephesians chapter 5, Paul is talking to the church in Ephesus, and this is what he says. He says, "Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children." I love that. That is such a cool word picture. But let's keep going. He gives instruction. "Walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave Himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma." We imitate Christ. We imitate God. And we do so as beloved children. If we are Christ's, if we are children of God, then we imitate our Father. And those of you who are parents in the room, think about your children. Think about when they were young, if they're not young anymore. But think about when they were young. They would imitate you, right? They would see what you do, and they would copy you, right? And sometimes that wasn't necessarily a good thing. I have some examples. I won't share any, but I have some examples. You guys know what I'm talking about. You parents know what I'm talking about, right? Ooh, did they just say that? Oh, they heard me say that. "What are you doing?" "Oh, I'm just doing what you do, Dad." "Yeah, I guess that's true." We need to imitate our Heavenly Father. But in order to do that, we need to know Him. We can't copy God if we don't know God. We can't do what He does if we don't know what He does. And the only way we can do that is if we are in the Word, is if we commune with Him, is if we pray, is if He really is our Heavenly Father. We also have godly examples to follow. We see this in Paul. We have a couple of examples that we see here in his letters, not just in Ephesians when he says that we should be imitators of God, but we also see this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. He says this, "Be imitators of me, just as I also am of Christ." It's a pretty bold thing to say, right? He's saying that he is an imitator of Christ, and so he is being a godly example for the church in Corinth. He also says this in Philippians chapter 3. This is a little bit more palatable, I guess, because it's hard for us to say, "God, well, okay, you must think pretty highly of yourself, right?" But this explains his heart. This explains where he's coming from when he says this in Philippians chapter 3. He says this, "I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let us, therefore, as many as are perfect, or complete, mature. That's what that Greek word means. Not necessarily perfect, sinless, but mature. As many of us as are mature, so to speak, have this attitude. And if in anything you have a different attitude, God will reveal that also to you. However, let us keep living by that same standard to which we have attained. Brethren, join in following my example and observe those who walk according to the pattern you have in us. For many walk, of whom I often told you and now tell you, even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their appetite, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their mind on earthly things. We as a church body look to our leadership to be examples to us, right? That's why the bar is so high for pastors and leaders in the church. We are to set the example that you can follow, right? That you can learn from. And we are attempting to attain to that standard as well, right? I am constantly seeking maturity in Christ. And hopefully you as a church are also. And so we have this standard. We have this pattern that we are walking. And that's why John is commending Gaius, because Gaius is walking in the truth. He is doing it. He's doing what he should be doing. He's showing love. He's showing hospitality. He's doing what he should be. And then we see, unfortunately, others who aren't. They are now enemies of the cross of Christ. This is not good. This is not good. We saw last week there is an example of what it looks like to be a false prophet. I mentioned this earlier, Matthew chapter 7. This is what he says. I talked about this last week. I'm going to talk about it again. Beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Grapes are not gathered from the thorn bushes, nor figs from thistles, are they? So every good tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. That's what the destruction that Paul was talking about just a moment ago. So then, you will know them by their fruits. We also see this in 1 John. This is actually really important. We need to understand this concept. When we get to 1 John, we'll get to this. But in 1 John chapter 3, this is what the Apostle John says. Little children, make sure no one deceives you. The one who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he, God, is righteous. The one who practices sin is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. The Son of God appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. No one who is born of God practices sin, because his seed abides in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. I want you to note that, church. I want you to note that. If you are abiding in sin, if you are practicing sin, if you are doing a lifestyle of sin, think about whose father you are, or who is your father. Think about whose son you are, or daughter. Whose example are you following? There is a bad end for those who walk in that way. We are called to walk according to the truth. We're called to walk according to the faith that we have. We talked about that last week in Ephesians chapter 4. Walk according to the calling with which you've been called. All right, let's finish this up. We got three more verses, four more verses in 3 John. Starting in verse 12, Demetrius has received a good testimony from everyone and from the truth itself, and we add our testimony, and you know that our testimony is true. I had many things to write to you, but I am not willing to write them to you with pen and ink, but I hope to see you shortly, and we will speak face to face. Peace be to you. The friends greet you. Greet the friends by by name. John is now commending another faithful brother, Demetrius, who some believe, and I would agree, that he is the one who is bearing this message of John to Gaius. He's the one who's carrying and delivering the letter to Gaius. Oftentimes, it was necessary to send a trusted disciple to deliver letters, as they would protect both the message and the letter itself. We didn't have email back then, right? They didn't have the post office back then. You had a letter, you sealed it with wax, you sent it with someone you trust. And not only did he protect the actual parchment, but he protected what was said inside. He stood for the truth. Demetrius had proven character and trustworthiness, and so he attested to him. And John concludes his letter by indicating that he has much more to say. This is a short letter. John has much more to say, but he would much rather say it in person and not on paper. And I honestly don't blame him, because it's a lot to write down, especially back then. You didn't have a computer, you had a pen and ink, right? He again indicates his intention to travel to Gaius, and presumably to the church that he is attempting to address. And that means also he will deal with Diotrephus. Very interesting stuff going on here. He concludes with a short blessing and a greeting to and from friends, and that is how 3 John concludes. We do have some application, though. I want to make sure that we understand as a church body that we need to recognize that church leadership is indicative of the spiritual health of a congregation. The church goes as the church leadership goes. And so, I want you to know, I take that very seriously. And while I am having to divide my time between working and doing church, I do want you to know that I am striving to be the leader that this church deserves. I'm striving to be a man who is willing to put the gospel ahead of myself. And so I hope, church, that you know that your leader is really trying to imitate Paul, so to speak, who then is imitating Christ, who is imitating God, right? That is my standard. And I try hard to live up to that. But it is also your place to hold me accountable. It's okay for you to tell me, hey, I think you're falling short in a particular area, right? It's okay to do that. It's okay to tell me, hey, I don't know if you're interpreting the Word of God correctly. Let's talk about this. I'm just a man. I may have a calling. I may have a gifting that I need to walk in, but I'm also just a man, and I'm imperfect, and so I need correction sometimes too. But I hope, church, that you know that if I have to correct one of you, I will do so in love. I hope, church, that you know that I consider you more important than myself, and I consider your spiritual health more important than anything else. And if there's something happening in your life that you need correction for, I hope you know that if I address that to you, I will do so out of love, and I will do so out of your well-being, not because I want to be like Diotrephus and have authority and influence over you and scare you into doing something you really shouldn't be doing. No, I take this role seriously, and so I hope you know that, church. But I want you to know that this is really, really important. And this is important in churches all around the globe. We're seeing churches nowadays that are just slipping because their pastors are embracing worldly things, embracing things that the Bible clearly speaks against and teaches against. And that's sad. That's sad. There are more churches closing in America than there are opening. And as a church planter, I take that very seriously. We open this church because the gospel needs to be shared, right? The gospel needs to be shared. One last thing. This is the same as we said last week. The evidence of our faith shows in whom we are imitating. Who do you look like in your actions, in your deeds, in your words? Who do you sound like? Do you sound like Christ? Do you look like Christ? Do you look like your Heavenly Father? Or do you look like the devil? Do you look like the world? Do you look like the culture? Who are you imitating? Only you can answer that. We can hold each other accountable. We can recognize the fruit. But only you can answer that question. Who are you imitating? Now, next week we will be going back into Genesis. We'll be picking up in Genesis chapter 12, which is actually exciting for me because I really enjoy studying the life of Abraham. He was an incredible man, and yet he also was human. And so we get to see both his righteousness and his failings. And I know, I mean, it's weird because we look at our leaders, we look at the heroes of our faith, and we think, oh man, they were righteous, they were perfect. They were men, just like me, just like you, unless you're a woman. But you get my drift. You understand what I'm saying. But we will be going back to Genesis 12.